Bart Arde, Earthlings. Welcome to a presentation about lockpicking for the next 45 minutes. My name is Walter Belgers. I'm Dutch, so Boa Tarde is about all I can say in Portuguese. Let me first start by saying that this is a wonderful stage. It's the most awesome stage I ever been at. So kudos for that. And also thanks for the organizers of having me and putting off this wonderful show with all of the volunteers helping. So I am been involved in lockpicking, opening locks without the keys, but also without destroying the lock, for over 20 years. And in the meantime, I've become the leader of TOOL, the Open Organization of Lockpickers. So we're a sport group. We come together to, as a sport, open locks that we own ourselves, of course, without the key. And that's a really interesting hobby. And I'm also one of the fastest lockpickers in the world at this moment. And yeah, thanks. So I have a long history of lockpicking, but I have also a long history in IT security. I've been in the IT security field for a long, long time. So also, if anybody still needs somebody for the quiz, and you need some real old school knowledge about Unix and the internet in the old days, I'm your man. Anyway, because I'm so long working in IT security and in lock security, I thought let's have a talk where I look at problems in IT security. Oh, and by the way, I almost forgot to say, I shouldn't mention this, I believe, but I was here 10 years ago as well, also talking about lockpicking. So I thought about locks and IT systems, because they are both technical puzzles, and they can be quite complicated. And if you want to break stuff, you need to understand how the lock works or how the IT system works. Maybe create some tools or use some available tools and try and circumvent the security. And in this case, this lock looked very complicated, but in the end, I was able with standard lock picking stuff to open it. So that got me thinking, breaking into computer systems is maybe not that different from breaking into locks. And in the end, you can totally, of course, own the system or the lock if you just know how to do this. And I think physical security is also overlooked often. So sometimes I've been a professional penetration tester for 15 years, even running a penetration testing company. We did a lot of assignments with customers looking at their IT systems. But if their data center has really lousy locks, then what good is your IT security? You can still break in if that is the weakest link. So I try to look at the system as a whole. And this was interesting at a conference in Romania. There was this challenge, hack the ATM system. And of course, the first thing I saw was not the IT system, but it was the lock. And it was actually quite easy to open the system. Unfortunately, although they said use tools and scripts of your liking, they didn't think lockpicking tools being official tools, so I didn't get a prize. But anyway, I was happy, as you can see. So, as I said, I was thinking about IT security and lock security, and I thought, well, there is quite a lot of similarities between the two, between hacking locks and hacking IT systems. And what I did was make this presentation, and I look at the software development lifecycle. So you start with the design of a system, you implement it, you test it, you deploy it, you update it, and in all those stages, you can have IT security problems, and in case of locks, lock problems. And in fact, many of those classes of vulnerabilities are the same in both. So I will be going over a few classes of security problems and show how they work in IT systems and in locks. So if you know about locks, you will learn something about IT and vice versa. Let's start with the beginning. You're designing a system. And during the design, if you then make an error, if you make an error in the design phase and you see that you made an error, you can easily fix it. But if it stays in there, it might become a problem when you deploy your system. And in many cases in IT systems that I've seen, people are really focusing on the systems to provide the functionality that you want to have. There is functional requirements, and you spend all your effort, and the deadline, of course, is getting closer, so you spend all your effort on making it functionally working. And of course, security is the opposite, is not doing what it should not supposed to be doing. And this can lead to problems. So in IT systems, here's a picture I made in Chernobyl, in Ukraine. This is the sarcophagus around the nuclear reactor of Chernobyl. And as you can see, the level is, it's 1.3 microsieverts per hour. That's about 10 times as much as that we have here. So that's not that bad, thanks to the sarcophagus. But this was actually a really a big design flaw of this type of reactor. So nobody has ever built any nuclear reactor with the same design again. So this can have far-reaching consequences. And staying in the rocket theme, maybe people will remember the Ariadne 5 rocket, which exploded. And the problem there was that there was some kind of exception, and the exception handler just shut off part of the software of this rocket. It became, it went the wrong way, and it self-exploded after that. And that was also a design problem. Because in this rocket, when there was a floating point exception, it should not shut down. It should just try to recover as best as it could. So can we also have design problems in locks? Well, actually, locks are always there to provide security. You buy a lock for it to be secure. So obviously, people will think about designing secure locks. Well, we'll think about security when designing a lock. And lock manufacturers are always good in the requirements. So if you buy a lock and you ask the locksmith, they will tell you what kind of attacks it is protecting you against and which ones it is not. Also, they are tested. The risks are pretty well understood. But I kept thinking, there must be some locks with a design flaw. So the manufacturers are really into security because it's a security system. And so if you buy a lock, it can protect against certain types of attacks. So maybe, for instance, you're worried that somebody who temporarily gets your key can make a copy. If that is your risk, then you need to have a lock with a key that you can't easily copy. But maybe you're not interested in copying at all, but you're interested to have a lock that you cannot easily break out of your door. So that's a whole different kind of attack, and it requires a different kind of lock. So depending on what risks you have, you can have different kinds of locks. But they do have design flaws, some of them. Here's an interesting example that was presented at an American conference at DEF CON. And this is a lock. As you can see, it has over here, it has an RFID reader. And above that, you can see that you also need to type in a code. So this is a two-factor authentication lock. You need to have a card, and you need to know the code. Sounds pretty secure, and in theory it is, but the design flaw is, as you can already see, that there are two LEDs in this lock, and if you take a paperclip and pry it next to the LED, it touches the PCB, the circuit board, it makes a short, and the system resets in the default state being open. So this is a really expensive government lock, but thanks to a design flaw, this is something that the designers did not think about. You can open it in seconds with a paperclip. Here's another one. This is a Winkhouse lock. The key is a bit of plastic that makes the turning move, that provides the turning motion. And also in there is a little microchip that uses wireless communication to talk to the lock. And if it sends the correct code, it will open. And actually, the electronical part is really well designed and made. And it uses really good, strong crypto. But the problem is that to operate the lock, below here, there's a thing that pulls down a pin, enabling the lock to turn. And one way of opening this pin as well is using a really big magnet, hold it in front of the lock, and that will also pull down the pin. So this lock can be circumvented with a big magnet. Also a design flaw. And this is actually a class of attacks, just as with IT systems. If you have a certain class, like injection problems, you can reuse that kind of attack on different systems. And here we also have the magnet problem in a gun. So the idea was that this gun has a fingerprint scanner, and only the owner of the gun can use it. So you take the gun, it recognizes your fingerprint, and it operates. But again, here it is shown that using a big magnet, the pin will also be pulled, and the gun is fully operational. So that's a design flaw. And here's a design flaw. This is quite old by now. This is a hotel lock where you need to insert a card to open the lock. And on the card, of course, is a key. But on the bottom of this lock, there's a little connector, and you can plug in a device, and it talks some kind of serial protocol. And it has an API. And you can call functions like read a piece of memory. And of course, you can abuse this. So this guy built a little Arduino-like system. You plug it in, it reads the whole memory of the lock. Somewhere, of course, in there is the key to open it. It fetches the key and then sends it back using another API call. Here's the key, and the lock opens. And the instructions on how to build this are online. And this is a really interesting one, if you haven't seen this before. This is the same lock we saw before. It has a different kind of weakness that you will find, again, this is a class of attacks that you will find in many locks, locking systems. And the problem here is inertia. So in the lock is this mechanism. And here you see a bolt that needs to go down for the lock to engage. So this is normally done using an electromagnet or a motor or whatever. But you can also use inertia. If you smash on it, then the energy is transferred and the bolt will also lower. And we can see this in action.
Toby.
So on the right, you see what is happening inside of the lock. I see some people haven't seen this this video before, but this works actually on more than just this lock. And this is a whole class of problems. And I think this is also a design problem, because when you're designing a lock, you should know about these kinds of attacks and make sure that they do not work on your lock. After the design comes the implementation. Implementation errors. We see this a lot in IT systems. If you do a security assessment and you ask, have you done this, have you done that? Everybody says yes, 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 yes. Check, tick all the boxes. But then in reality, it turns out that the implementation might have some problems here and there, giving rise to all kinds of problems. In the locking world, it was a bit harder for me to find really examples of how locks fail in the implementation phase. Implementation of lock is not that difficult normally, but I have one example which is shown here in this video.
If you insert the blank into the lock, you put a little tension on it, you take the blank out and then turn it, well, like this, the lock opens. And it's a big design flaw in this lock. And here I'm going to try another one. Another technique that works is put tension on it, pull the key out, stick the tip in and open the lock. Now, as you can see, it's a really severe vulnerability. And the thing that...
This was a bike lock in the Netherlands. The manufacturer has fixed this problem. But what is actually happening here? Well, this is what is happening in a normal lock. So if you have a normal lock, there's pins inside, actually stacks of two pins, and you have the key, which is bitted to exactly match the length of the pins. And if you insert the right key, you can rotate the lock. Now, in this case, the implementation error was that they used the wrong pins on the bottom. So as you can see here, the bottom pins are too wide. They are wider than the top pins. And why is this a problem? Now, if you take a blank key, so this is a key that fits the lock but doesn't operate, it pushes all the pins down as far as it can. So they're all pushed down too far. And now if I keep applying a bit of tension and pull out the key, the blue pins will pop up until they reach the correct position. And I can probably demonstrate it with this lock. Oh no, the dreaded demo effect. So you take it out almost completely, you release a little bit, and it turns. So this is a lock we prepared to have the same flaw. And this is an implementation error. Right, we've implemented the system, designed it, implemented it. Next up is using it. And of course, then we have user error. So maybe you've designed it pretty well, and then end users are going to fiddle with it, and then all kinds of problems arise as well. Now, do we have this in IT systems? Yes, we know. It's always a problem with awareness. And this guy was a minister in Greece, and that was the actual picture on the official Greek government website. And on this picture, you can see his post-it memo with his password. If you now go to the website, I'm not really sure if he's still in the government, but what they did was they cropped the picture, so the post-it memo was gone. So this is a big problem in the IT world. Passwords, awareness, password guessing, passwords are terrible. We should have gotten rid of passwords a long time ago, but somehow it's really, they're too easy to get rid of easily. So passwords are still a pain. They are easy to guess, they are easy to lose. People can be social engineered into giving away their passwords. But with locks, do we have passwords? Well, yeah. This is the password to the lock. It's the key. And nowadays, many people understand that they shouldn't give away their password. But do you also understand you shouldn't let people look at your key, which is your password to your house? That's not as common. So that's a real problem, and getting a bigger problem every day. Showing your keys. This is from a NBC show. There was a gang robbing gas stations in the United States. Those gas stations have boxes where you can pay with your credit card. And they would open them up and put in a skimming device. But to open them up, you need to have the key. Well, they got hands on one of the keys, and lo and behold, this key will work on all of the boxes on all of the gas stations throughout the United States. So once you have the key, you can open them all up and put in skimming devices. Now, the NBC reported on this, and what did they do on television? And actually, this is a really simple key, but you can also see here it says Y11, and that is the type of key. I mean, the key has a bitting or a profile here, and that profile is the Y11. So you can just go to the shop and buy a Y11 key, and then all you need is these cuts here below. But these are, well, there are maybe 7 or 9 possibilities, or for this key maybe even 5 or 3. And just by looking at this picture, you have enough information to create a duplicate of this key. So this is your password, which you are showing to other people. And this happens again and again. Another example, somebody from eBay, policeman in or a fireman, I don't know, in New York, sold his old bunch of keys that the policemen have in New York. And this key ring contains keys to operate electrical panels, fire elevator key, traffic light key, service key. Those are interesting keys, and they're all the same over the whole city of New York. So the guy who bought this key ring could enter a lot of boxes. And then the problem is, people started saying, "Oh, it shouldn't. This guy should not have sold those keys on eBay." And they made an article about it, showing this picture. So now this picture is out on the internet. You cannot take it back. What's on the internet stays on the internet. So now you can make your own New York keys, and those are also not the most complicated keys. On the bottom left, you see a key that's really complicated, and that's interesting. It's from a Swiss lock manufacturer, and they have keys where they actually drill extra holes that have no purpose other than making it harder to make a copy by just looking at it, which I think is a smart thing to do. But in the end, if you can make a copy, see the key, you can probably make a copy. Let's look at this video that stars famous Dutch hacker Rob Kongrijp in the Amsterdam subway system. What he was saying in Dutch is that he was in the metro station, and he wasn't using the buttons in the elevator, but he was using the key. And when you use the key, the elevator goes to a floor that is not announced in the elevator and brings you to the nuclear shelter in underneath the metro, the subway station. So he also showed the key. What are your thoughts if you see this key? Sorry?
Can replicate it.
Yeah. That's quite a simple key, right? Well, the trick is this was Rob Kongrijp. He's a famous hacker. He knows this stuff. This was just a key he took from his desk to show to the cameraman. I mean, it works still the same for the theatrical element. It works. You don't have to show your real keys. So this is just a simple key from a cabinet. Thinking a bit further about different kinds of attacks on IT systems, backdoors cross my mind. Backdoors. You have backdoors in IT systems. NSA has been trying to backdoor all kinds of stuff. It goes back to 2003 when somebody tried to put stuff in the Linux kernel to make a backdoor. So we can backdoor IT systems. Can we backdoor a lock? Yeah. If you buy a cheap safe lock with an electronic keypad, they're always backdoored. And by that I mean that apart from using the code, you can also use an emergency key. Because the problem with these things is that for the code to work, you need the batteries to be full. And if you run out of battery, you cannot open the safe anymore. So what do you do if you are the safe builder or designer? You put in a back door, so you have an emergency way of getting access to the safe. And that's done using a regular key. And if you look at those little safes, always they have some kind of a plastic panel that you can take off. And behind that is a keyhole for the emergency key. And of course, this is always a very simple key that can easily be lockpicked. So yes, we do have backdoors in safes. But can we also have them in standard cylinders that we have on our door? Well, if the NSA has backdoored my cylinder at home, I wouldn't know because I haven't opened it up. But I do know that in the old days, when there was still the Iron Curtain, behind the Iron Curtain, we had Eastern Germany, and there was the secret police, the Stasi. And the Stasi, they had backdoored the locks. So, of course, in Eastern Germany, you could only buy locks from the state supplier. And this is one of those locks. And how does this backdooring work? I've shown you before how a normal lock works. So you have a key that presses down on the pins, and they should all align. And in this case, there is enough room in the bottom of the lock to hold both parts of the pin. So if you have a key that pushes all the pins all the way down, then everything is out of the way and you can operate the lock. So you have a special key that looks like a comb. It's called the heavenly key, or Himmelschlüssel in German. And this will open the lock, and it works really, really well. And of course, if you buy a standard cylinder, this doesn't work, because lock manufacturers know about these kinds of attacks. But if you buy really cheap Chinese padlocks, you might find that they also have this flaw. So you need a combing device, and also the spacing of the pins on this need to match the spacing of the lock, so you have different spacings. And then if you use this, and the hard part is getting it on the pins, yeah, you can open the lock. So that's a back door. Let's move on. Key reuse. Now we're coming into the realm of crypto. If you're doing crypto, now crypto is really, really hard. One of the problems you could face is people reusing crypto keys. And that's a problem. If you reuse the same key, you can do all kinds of mathematical attacks on crypto systems. Actually, it was also used in World War II, where the same message was encrypted. The same key was used to encrypt multiple messages because the people sending the messages ran out of keys. And this helped the Allies to break the German codes. In locks, as I said, the key is the password is the key. Key reuse means reuse of key. Well, there's something similar or like it. In locks, you can have multiple keys operating on the same lock, which is called a master key system. So you will find this, for instance, in buildings where you have one lock on the front door that is shared by many people renting a space. And then every other door has a unique lock. But all those keys will also operate the lock on the outside door. Now, how can you do this? There are several ways of doing this. Maybe the outside door lock only has one pin. That would be one way to doing it. But a better way is to cut the pins into half. So here on the left, you see a lock that is being master keyed. So the pins are not two parts, but they are three parts. So this means there are two different positions where the pin can be in the correct, can be correct. Two positions in which the lock can open. So that's a bit like key reuse. And here you see on the left one of these locks closed, and on the right you see the same lock opened by one of the keys that operates this lock. Now the thing is that if you do this, it weakens the system. So if I live in an apartment complex and I have such a lock, what I can do is I can look at my own key. Of course, I don't learn anything new, but then I can open the lock, and I can because I have the key, and I can disassemble it, and I can take out all the parts, and I can deduce what the other possibilities are. So by looking at my own key and looking at the other possibilities, I can create a second key or multiple other keys that will also operate on my lock. And one of these keys is the master key. Normally, there, if in a master key system, there's one key that operates on all the locks, and that also needs to operate on my lock. So with this information, I can actually create the master key for the whole system. So that's a problem with the key reuse. And that's a problem you can't really solve well in mechanical locks. So a master key is a key that operates on all the locks. And that in itself is also a vulnerability, having something or somebody who has access to everything. So if you're doing penetration tests, what you normally do is you try to get a foothold. First you get entry into a unpatched system and you become a regular user. Then you work your way up to becoming root or admin and then domain admin. And once you have that, you have access to everything. So often there is a omnipotent user that can do anything. And believe it or not, but you have the same thing in locks. Actually, I talked about this before. I said that all the boxes in the gas stations had the same key. That's an example of a root user, a key that operates all the same locks. And you see this more often than you might think. So here's a few pictures I made of systems that all have the same key, because you don't want people, service people, to walk with 100 keys. No, they have one key, and all the places they need to get into have the same lock. So if you're a service mechanic for, I don't know, GSM antennas, then the doors to these antennas will all have the same key for the same operator. Actually, I also walked around Lisboa yesterday, and I took some pictures. So yes, obviously, also here, all these systems have locks that need to be opened by field service people, and they all share the same key. So once you are able to get a key to open the metro systems or the post office box, then you can open them all. So that's a problem. Sample code. I don't see this much in IT world anymore. In the old days, you could get sample code that was shipped in with the existing software or in books that was not secure enough. So if you use sample code, you might have a problem. Do we have sample code in locks? Yes, we also have sample code in locks. We have sample keys in locks. If you go to a wholesale company selling cylinders, locks, and you say, I want a standard cylinder, chances are you get a lock with the same key. So this reseller probably has 1,000 locks, and if you want five, you get five from the batch of 1,000. And they all have the same key, because it's cheaper to make. And that leads to problems, as you can see in this video.
Over iemand die beweert dat je heel eenvoudig met een sleuteltje de flitspalen open krijgt. En dat je ook die slotjes heel gemakkelijk kan kopen. Ik onderzoek dat. Sleuteltje halen. Dan heb ik drie sleuteltjes. Volgens de mailschrijver zit dit in de flitspaal. En kan ik met die sleuteltjes de flitspaal openen. Want het geheim van deze paal zit in deze kast. Dus je hebt hier een slotje. Zie je dit sleuteltje? Doe dit niet thuis. Oh.
What's going on here? Well, this was from Flemish television in Belgium. And this is a vendor of speed cameras. And they also went to a wholesale company saying, I want to have a bunch of locks. And this reporter went to the same company saying, I want a bunch of locks. And he got the same locks with the same keys as the speed cameras. Now, if you paid attention, what did you see? A still frame of the key, correct. So I actually got this from YouTube, and I made a printout of this, and I measured it, and I wasn't completely sure. There was one bitting that could be one of two possibilities. So I made two keys. I went over to Belgium. I only live 40 kilometers from Belgium. I tried it out, and it worked. By the way, it's legal. I've been told that it's legal in Belgium to open this box as long as you leave it intact. And it's even legal to turn it off by the main switch as long as you keep it intact. So, 0 days. Yeah, we have 0 days in software. Do we have 0 days in hardware? Of course. And of course, we also have responsible disclosure or coordinated vulnerability disclosure, whatever you want to call it. Here's an example of a very old 0 day. Now this is a company that makes electronic locks, and this ring you see is an aluminum ring with four magnets inside. And what happens is that if you turn it, then inside is an electromotor. By turning it, the magnetic field will generate electricity, and that will actually operate the mechanism inside. So you can use this to open and close the lock again. But this was a not so nice story because this was a zero day. They had not spoken to the company. And at the same day, some other company was starting to sell those rings. So that was not very nice. As Tool, we try to talk to the companies. The companies are more and more willing to talk with us. So we try out their prototypes and help them in the early stages to fix their designs. Now, PR, we also have seen, this is also an old example, but sometimes in the IT world, people start bragging about how unbreakable their software is. And of course, the reaction will be of people breaking it. In the lock industry, we have the same. In the United States, there's this company, Medico. They make really nice high security cylinders. And they once said, well, we have a new cylinder, and this is totally unbreakable. So this guy, Mark Weber, Tobias, spent half a year together with another guy on finding out how he could circumvent this lock security. And in the end, he was able to open them within 30 seconds. So that backfired a little bit. Let's skip this. Brute force attacks. We have that in software, brute forcing passwords. Can we do that in hardware? Well, not so easy for the regular locks. So regular locks, we don't have any automated robots that will try out all the possibilities. I mean, in theory, it should be doable. But also, it would take a huge amount of time. There's one exception, though. There is also safe locks, where you need to dial the code. And these can be brute forced. So you can buy, or you can even build yourself, tools that you pop onto the safe, and it will just try every combination. Well, not every combination, because if the dial goes from 0 to 100, normally you can skip every other code, because there's a little bit of tolerance. And this will take you maybe 3 days or something to open the lock. And that's good enough for the safe. I mean, the safe was not designed to withstand an attack for a week or so. It needs to be safe enough for a burglar to give up in a few hours. Denial of service. Easy in IT systems, easy in locks. You don't see it often, because not many people try such an attack, but if you have a bit of glue, or even you have special keys that really insert easily, but if you try to get them out, they won't come out, and you can break off the end of the key. So this is a really effective denial of service attack on locks. Sequential attacks, we also have them. So in IT systems, if you can first attack the username, and because it gives a different error message if you have the wrong user or an existing user with the wrong password, you can enumerate users, and then you can start enumerating the password, like a sequential attack. That's also present in locks. So in locks, sometimes you have two things, two rows of pins you need to set to the correct position. So this is an ASA twin. It has two rows of pins. But the thing is that the way you do lock picking, you need to push the pins to the correct position, and it's not totally random in which order. It is one row first, and then the other row. So it's like a sequential attack. And that goes for all these systems. So this is an EVA 3KS lock. It has wavers, that sliders, and pins. You first do all the pins, and then the sliders, or vice versa. It's a sequential attack. And this is a Medico. Here, the pins are cut in a certain angle, so the pins not only go up and down, but they also rotate, because the key is cut at a certain angle. And again, for this lock, you first need to set the pins to the correct depth, and then it will seem to open a little bit, and then you need to turn and get them in the correct angle. In IT, we have security testing. That's pretty hard to do well, because we don't really have any certification. Well, we have certification on processes, but how can you really certify that your application is really secure? That's really hard. In lock systems, those are much smaller. The attacks are well known. It's much easier to do certification. So depending on which country you are in, there are different kinds of certification. This is a German lock from Dohm, and they also brought this lock to the Dutch market. And there it got certified, as you can see by the stamp SKG, 2-star, that's a certification. But do you see the difference between this lock and this lock? Yes, it is.
That's a metal thing.
It's a metal thing. Yeah, there's a little little ball there, a ball bearing. The thing is, this lock was brought to the SKG, and they were able to open it within 3 minutes, maybe 2:58. Don't laugh, because the certification, if you may use every bit of force and whatever you have, 1, 2, or 3 stars means 2, 3, or 5 minutes resistant. 5 minutes resistance is already really good for a lock. So this lock came a few seconds short of getting the second star. And they thought, and the problem is that somebody could drill a hole through the whole lock and just destroy it. And they thought, how can we fix this? And it must not cost much. And then they had the brilliant idea of putting in this little ball bearing. That's really cheap. You just drill a little hole, pop in the ball bearing. Those are also really cheap. And now it's become harder to drill. So now it was more than 3 minutes, and they got the second star. As you know, the tooling in the IT world gets better and better. You have to know less and less to be able to use those tools, to become script kiddie, essentially. And that's the same in the locking world. And we see only now that this is really progressing very fast, especially in the field of 3D printing. It becomes much more easy to print keys. And for a long time, manufacturers have been working on new patents on their keys, including movable elements in the key, also to make it harder to duplicate them, because you need to have the official key with the movable element. But nowadays, like this movable element, by printing a key and then putting in a movable element manually, it actually becomes possible to remake really high secure keys. So this is becoming more and more of a problem, which is why it also becomes more and more important to not show your keys to anybody. Now, in the end, you get what you pay for. You can't see how secure a piece of software is. You need to have somebody to really look at it. And we can't all be security experts. It's the same with locks. With locks, you can see something. You can have some idea. But again, you need to be really a lock expert to understand how secure a specific lock is. Here is a couple of locks that we used in a competition in the Netherlands. So people could try and open those locks, but then keep on trying. So if maybe the first time you open the lock in 20 minutes, then you can try again and again and again and make your time really, make it really fast, the opening. So let's see hands who thinks that the lock on the left is the most secure, is the hardest to open. Nobody. What about lock number 2, the BKS? No? Lock 3? Yes? Few. Lock 4, the ICO. More people. Lock 5. Most people. Here are the times. So yes, the last one was actually the hardest. Took 4:49. And the one on the right took only 2 seconds and a bit. That includes the time of starting and stopping your stopwatch. Sorry? 2-star, yes, but the stars don't take into account a sophisticated lockpicker. It's more about techniques that burglars use. Burglars don't lockpick, they smash the lock, drill the lock, break the lock, whatever. And for that, this gets 2 stars. And awareness is a problem, so let's wrap this up. Awareness in IT is a problem, in locks also. So sometimes I see people who buy a lock that costs €1.50, and they think that it is secure. Well, this lock, it does work, but if I take the key out one notch, it still operates the lock. How is this possible? This is such an incredibly bad lock, and you should be fined if you try to put this on your door. So, apart from this trying to be entertaining, I also have one message for you to take home, and that is that security is not just IT or not just locks. You need to have the holistic view. If your IT systems are wholly secure, but I can easily break into your facility via the locks, via the doors, and get to your disks, it is still game over. So you need to, and breaking in doesn't mean doing lock picking and getting through your lock. but there also, of course, there are many other ways of getting into your facility, circumventing the locks altogether. So you need to really have an open eye for all the vulnerabilities in your facility to get to your data. So it's actually about threat modeling, really sitting down and thinking about, if I were an attacker, how would I try to get in with a blank sheet of paper? Right, so that wraps it up. I will be here for the coming days. I will also be giving a workshop in lockpicking. That will be tomorrow at 8 o'clock somewhere. I think it's in the workshop room, but I'm not really sure. Check the agenda. I also have some lockpicking tools for sale if you might be interested, or if you want to know more about lockpicking at all, just find me. And tomorrow I also have a talk about a TTL microcomputer built out of TTL chips. So I guess we have maybe a couple of minutes left if there are any questions. Yes?
Is there much innovation in the market?
Is there much innovation in the market? Yes, well, in the mechanical market, there are some companies who do innovation. For instance, EVA is a company that really makes really interesting mechanical locks, and they do a really good job. But many of the lock manufacturers just produce in cheap countries and use standard locks. Of course, there's a lot of innovation with new designers, new inventors who make new locks that are electronic. But you see that the people who make electronic locks, they either understand electronics and they fail in the mechanical part, or they understand the mechanics but they fail in the electronic part. So I don't have an electronic door, a lock on my door yet until they improve a little bit.
Do you know if there are manufacturers using new technologies like 3D printing with metal to make?
Yeah, do I know if there are manufacturers who use new technologies like 3D printing to make complex systems? Yes, there's one company, Stealth Lock, Stealth Key, I'm not sure. They really believe that we need to have keys where if you show the key, you cannot see how it works. So they have keys that have that are wrapped around, and the bitting is on the inside. And they are being 3D printed out of steel. But that's actually the only example I can think of right now. And that is just the key, not the lock. I don't know of any companies doing 3D printing for locks. No, that's all really pretty old school metalworking. Okay, I guess that wraps it up. Thanks for being here. Cheers.